Tell me the story of Jesus. Write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Tell how the angels in chorus sang as they welcomed his birth. Glory to God in the highest, peace and good tidings to earth. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Fasting alone in the desert, tell of your days that are past. How for our sins he was tempted, yet was triumphant at last. Tell of the years of his labor, tell of the sorrow he bore. He was despised and afflicted, homeless, rejected, and poor. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Tell of the cross where they nailed him, writhing in anguish and pain. Tell of the grave where they laid him, tell how he liveth again. Love in that story so tender, clearer than ever I see. Lay, let me weep while you whisper, love pay the ransom for me. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard.
Amen. Have a seat.
Morning, church family, visitors. Thank you for coming. Psalm 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the godly, nor standeth in the way, nor seth in the, but his delight is in the law. And in his law doth he meditate. He will, and he shall be like a tree planted by the water. He shall be, sorry about that, I lost my spot. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of the water that bringeth forth the fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doth shall prosper.
I'm only going to use it so that people on internet, Facebook, can hear it. Otherwise, I could talk loud enough, you could all hear me. Pretty sure of that. All right. So, no, I'm not Missy. I know some of you are shocked by the looks on your faces. But she's not here this morning, so I've got the announcements. She said, we are honored to welcome Ken York. Mr. York, thanks for being here. He's going to be here again tonight, Monday night, Tuesday night, and Wednesday night, if you don't already know that. 6 to 9. And those of you that think 6 to 9, well, I got to eat dinner. Guess what? They're feeding you, so you better show up. All right? Sloppy Joe's. Now I wish I was going to be in town. I won't be here. I'm out of town. So, say this tonight. I'll probably be here tonight then. All right. On the 17th of April, everybody know what the 17th of April is? What is it? It's Easter. Come on, I mean, my gosh, people, wake up out there. It's Easter. We're also going to have the biggest, the baddest Easter egg hunt ever. Well, we're saying it again this year. It gets better every year. You don't know that? Just like age, you get better every year, right? Yeah. All right. They'll have fun prizes for the kiddos. Invite your friends and family to join us for Easter service that day as well. The last little thing I have is security. I have some reminders after this. Next Saturday. The 19th. And sorry, I keep changing this, guys. The 19th, we're going to meet at Mad River Armory at 4 p.m. Okay? I try to reserve lanes. They don't reserve them. However, they said that their attendance at that time usually drops. They said they should be able to accommodate us. I told them there'd be between 10 and 15 of us there. So they should be able to accommodate us for a little bit of practice. Okay? And I thought afterwards we'd be out to eat. I'm thinking wings. Wings? Okay. All right. So we'll see if we can work that out too. Do what? Hey, it's not that good looking. I can't buy it. I can't buy it with my good looks because it's not that good looking. All right. Couple of reminders here. Wednesday night equip service starts at 7 p.m. except for this week, of course. 10 a.m. Sunday mornings, engage classes for all ages. So if you haven't been coming and you can make those classes, please come. First quarter 90-day challenge ends this month. As a church family, let's commit together to make more focused and purposeful prayer for folks and let them know that you have phone calls in person, by a text, by email. Let people know you're praying for them. Little emojis on Facebook or whatever it may be. It works too, I would assume. So join in the fun. Keep track of your prayers. And this says, let Tim know how many people prayed for that week on Sundays. Our goal is to have 1,101 prayers by the end of March. Tim, do you know where we are? Are we over 1,000? All right, good job, good job. Let's see if we can set a new record, though, because, you know, next year Anthony's going to want us to do one more, okay? So you guys have been knocking it out of the park. Slow down a little bit. Just kidding. All right, and that's all I've got for this morning. Thanks.
You know, I didn't want this, right? can you tell? So good to see everybody here this morning. I don't know about everyone else, but I'm really excited about the revival this week. Let's all pray for a good turnout. Let's try and recruit. I know we all have family, we all have friends, we all have coworkers. A lot of people out there that don't know the Lord. I know we can't drag them here, but, you know, we can plant a seed and try and invite everybody we can. So let's just go to the Lord in prayer for the offering. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to gather here and praise you, Lord, and worship you, Father. We ask for discernment for our pastor, for the funds that we collect through the basket and through tithe.ly for the folks that give online. And we just pray that the money and funds that we bring in will be used to further your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning once again. Please stand. Let's continue our worship. Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. Has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again, for your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things, and you do great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave, you free every captive and break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, your Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things.
Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you. Done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. You've done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. You have done
great things, oh God, you have done great things.
Doesn't Lena sound great?
Seated. I hope everyone's enjoying the service so far. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We got cake and ice cream afterwards. That is what I'm talking about. Amen.
Amen.
I like it. You don't even got to get in your car,
go anywhere. You just walk to the back room and it's there.
And we got Valerie Farmhouse Bakery. And you know, how many have seen the show
600-pound Life?
My life was changed by that. And not because of the show, actually, it was because of a Facebook post. You know, because when I watch that show, I usually eat some ice cream or something like that. You know, I'm enjoying. And in the post, it said, "Everyone is married on 600-pound Life. Go ahead and eat that cupcake." And that changed my life right there. I was like, you know what? If they're married, I'm gonna stay married. I'm eating cake and ice cream as much as I want. Amen. Well, we're excited. This is our 8-year anniversary service. We will have cake and ice cream after the service. And then we'll have, this is our revival. And we're excited. We have Brother Kent York with us. He's going to come, if you would. He's going to give us a short introduction real quick. And then he's going to talk about the Royal Rumble. And so if you would, make him feel welcome this morning.
Thank you, preacher. Well, are you glad to be here this morning? Say amen. Amen. Now look over at the person next to you and say, my, you're good looking. That was worth getting out of bed for, wasn't it? I'll tell you. Well, we are glad to be here today. My name is Kent York. I am an evangelist, and we're going to have a revival this week. Now, I've been an itinerant evangelist now for 23 years, and I do about 39 of these meetings a year for the last 23 years. And anytime I do a revival, there's always three people in the crowd, and they're all here this morning. There's group number one, and they're like this. Yahoo! Whoopee! We're going to have revival! We're going to church Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, and woo! They're excited! And I love those people like that. How many we got like that? All right, we got six. All right. Brother Anthony, I thought you was going to work this up into a lather for me. You know why those six people are excited? Because they've probably been in a great revival before, and they've seen how God would work, and they've seen marriages put back together, and they've seen souls saved, and they've seen people revived for Jesus Christ, and they believe we can do it again this week. And I love those six people. You're my favorite people in the world. And then there's group number two. Group number two. And they're kind of like this. What's he gonna do? You've never been in a revival. You've never met an evangelist. If you were bit by a revival, you won't even know what bit you, huh? You have never been part of a great church revival. And what you need to do, if you're in group number two, is you need to take what I call the revival challenge. And the revival challenge is to be here for all five of my messages. Do you realize I've only got five cracks at you people? Do you understand that? I'm going to preach here in a minute. Then I'm going to preach tonight at 6 o'clock. And then Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday at 7 o'clock. And then I'm out of here. I'm headed to, I fly to Tulsa, Oklahoma Saturday. I'm gone. I'm on to my next meeting. Five shots at you. And you need to take the challenge. I'm going to be here for all five of those messages. Now, let me tell you something. The devil's going to do everything in his power to keep you from coming. In fact, I've already met a couple of you. You already started making your excuses. Well, I can't come Tuesday night. That's my bowling league. Well, you need to call the bowling league and tell them you ain't coming Tuesday night, because God's more important than a bowling ball. Let me just say this. If you can't be here every night of the meeting, don't come up and tell me after the service, because it irritates me, all right? Just keep it to yourself. You're just going to miss it. But you know what? If you'd take the revival challenge, God would do something in your life. I had a guy who didn't believe me one day. I got up and I said, don't tell me. And after service, he'd come back. He said, Brother Kent, I'll be here tonight, but I can't be here Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday. I work late every night of the week. And it irritated me. And I got up in the pulpit and I said, hey, if you got to work late every night of the week, I want you to go into your boss this week. Tell him you're in revival this week and it's one of the most important parts of your religious life and you need to get off early every day to go to revival. And if he won't let you off early, you tell him there was a guy that worked for Walmart and they wouldn't let him off to go to church, and he sued Walmart, and Walmart had to pay $250,000. Look your boss in the eye and just go, make my day. You know what that guy did? He went to work the next morning, and he told the boss exactly what I said. The boss said, take off early all week. Tuesday night, the boss came to the revival with him. Wednesday night, four members of that man's family got saved. His wife went out the door. Yeah, praise the Lord. His wife went out the door Wednesday night, and she had tears in her face. She said, "Brother Kent, my husband works late every night of the week. This has been the best week of our life. We've gone out and had a date before church every night. And tonight, four members of our family got saved." You see, there was a man who said, "You know what? I'm willing to adjust my schedule a little bit for God." And God blessed him. And I'm going to tell you, if you'll take the revival challenge and say, "I'm not going to make an excuse. I'm going to put God first this week," be here for revival and watch God bless you. Then there's group number three. You thought I forgot about you. You're like, "I'm not in those first two." Group number three is like this. "I don't want no revival. You've been mad ever since Brother Anthony brought it up. Brother Anthony, you knothead! Why do you schedule stupid stuff like this? We don't want to go to church Monday and Tuesday night." You're mad about it. You know why? Well, to be honest, you're just like group number one. You know what revival could be in your life, and you don't want to change. I read the other day, the only time Baptists like to be changed is when they're a baby in the nursery. You say, "What do you mean, Brother Kent?" There's some of you that need to change the way you're living. And you say, "What do you mean?" You need to bring God to the front and you go to the back. You see, it wouldn't be bad if God was second or third in most of your lives. But I hate to say it, some of you, God is 10th and 12th in your life. God deserves to be number one in your life. So you know what would be wonderful this week? Let's all get in group number one. Let's just decide Brother Kent's here. We're going to have singing. We're going to have preaching. We're going to have revival this week. They're even, I think they're feeding you at 6 o'clock. They're going to have a free meal for you. Just come to revival and watch what God will do. And if you'll take that challenge, I guarantee you Wednesday night you'll walk out of here going, "God did something in my heart this week." But you got to give him the chance. Now, we're going to have a little campaign this week, and we call it "Let's Get Ready to Rumble." We're going to rumble this week. How many like that WWF wrestling? How many like that? Well, I'm proud of you people. You're the only people that's ever admitted to that in a church service. So. Man, that is honesty. I like that. Thank you, George. I like that. Thank you, honesty. Because most people lie and say, "Oh, no, I never watch that stuff." We're going to rumble Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday night. We have two teams each night. Now, the way the rumble works is at the close of the service this morning, Brother Anthony, at the very last amen, at the very last dismissal, we're going to give our six team leaders about 10 seconds to strategically locate themselves in the building. And these people are going to be coming up to you, and they're going to be asking one question. Will you come and stand up for me on whatever their night is? Monday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night. Would you stand for me Monday night? Would you stand for me Tuesday night? You don't have to buy them a dinner. You don't have to give them $20. All you got to do is say, "Yes, I will come on your night and stand up for you." And the team with the greatest score will be our winner each night. Now, the scoring works like this. Every person that stands is worth 1 point. But if that person is not a member of Revived Baptist Church, they're worth 5 extra points. Now let's go over the rules real quick. What is a member of Revived Baptist Church? A member is a member and a non-member is a non-member. I didn't say attender, I said member. If you've never joined this church, you're not a member of the church. You're worth 6 points. Keep in mind that most children have not joined the church yet because they're not old enough yet. They're not a member. Keep in mind that I'm not a member. I'm a big fish. Yeah, I'm worth 6 points. All right, they're going to be asking you to stand up for them. The team with the greatest score each night will be our winner. Runner-up will be the one that's just a little bit shorter than that. At the end of the week, the team with the greatest score will win a fabulous grand prize. That's the way it's going to work. And right now, we're going to meet our team leaders. And I want you to stand up if I call your name and stay standing. Monday night, we're going to have Gary and Anita. Where's Gary and Anita? There they are. Come on, Gary, some enthusiasm. Stay up. They're going to rumble against George and Betty. Hey, George and Betty, give them a hand. All right. Now, Gary, do you have any trash talk for George and Betty?
We're going to bust you up.
Oh. Okay, George is ready. Let's give these two teams a big hand. Y'all can be seated. This is going to be brutal Monday night. Tuesday night. Yeah, he did. He was boxing over there. All right. Tuesday, Robin Amber. Where's Robin Amber? Stand up. There they are. They're going to rumble against Gary and Laura. Gary and Laura right here. Look at there. All right, Gary, got any trash talk? Oh, that was so Christian of you. Thank you. Let's give these two teams a big hand. Tuesday night. And then Wednesday night, David and Lisa. Where's David and Lisa? There they are. Whoa, there's David. David's in the sound booth back there. And they're going to rumble against Joe and Casey. Stand up, Joe and Casey. There. Back there. All right. How about it, David? You got any trash talk for Joe back there? They're going down. All right. All right, we're going to have fun with this each night, and we will give them, Brother Anthony, a few seconds at the close of the service so they can spread out. Don't be shocked when they come up to you. Just say, yes, I'll stand for you on their night, and they would truly appreciate this. Folks, let me tell you something. We're going to have fun this week, but we're going to get serious this week. And my prayer is that God will really do a work in your heart. And if you've got somebody here that in this city that's not saved, you need to get them to this meeting so they can hear about Jesus Christ. And we'll pray that God will give us some souls. Well, we're going to have one more number just before I come back and preach. So, Gary, come on, sing one more, and I'll be right back.
This is very special. You stay seated. As we sing this song, you may feel like standing up and raising your hands, and you are perfectly welcome to do that. It's called Blessing. Amen. favor be upon you and a thousand generations.
And your family and your children and their children and their children.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations.
And your family and your children and their children and their children.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations. And your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He's with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in his coming and his going, in his weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you. Children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He's with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you. Amen, 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 amen,
Thank you, team. Open your Bibles this morning. We're going to go to the book of 1 Peter, chapter number 5. 1 Peter, chapter number 5. I was promised a pulpit up here. 1 Peter, chapter 5. By somebody who will go unnamed. Oh, here he comes. Thank you, Gary. All right, 1 Peter chapter 5, go down and find verse number 5. As soon as you find your place in God's Word, let's stand, and we're going to honor the Bible as we read it by standing. I love to honor that old book when we begin our messages. If you don't have your Bible, I believe the words will be up on the screen. You can follow along. Now, let me tell you what is the great key to revival. We can have a nice building like this, get it all remodeled and spick and span and clean. And by the way, let me congratulate you on your 8th anniversary. And I was at Revive Baptist when you met in an old school building at one time. And then I was at the bank building. And this is my first time to be here. And let me congratulate you on having this beautiful facility today, and congratulations on 8 years, Brother Anthony and Lacey, for being here. But you can bring in an evangelist, we can have good music, we can have a nice building, but we cannot have revival till he gets involved. And the way we get God involved is through prayer. And one thing I do in all my meetings, I've never deviated now in 23 years, right after I read my passage, I'll invite anyone that would like to come down and kneel with me around the altar, and we'll have a word of prayer. Because I believe that strongly, we've got to get God in this meeting. Now, there'll be some of you that'll say, Brother Kent, I'm not comfortable coming down there and praying with you. Well, if you're not, that's fine. You can just be seated after we read. Or if you're physically unable, I understand. I know there's a couple of you, if we ever got you down, we'd never get you up again. And I'm sorry about that. But if you're willing and you want to, we'll do this in every service. We'll pray before I preach. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 5. It says, likewise, ye younger, submit yourself unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another, and be clothed with humility. For God resisteth the proud, and he giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he might exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. I invite anyone that would like to come on down and join me around the altar. We're going to kneel and pray. The remainder, you can be seated, but you're welcome to join me. Come on. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Come join me. Amen. Thank you. We can also kneel on those front chairs if you'd like to. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. It's good to be in your house. We've already had a lot of fun, and we've already praised your name through music. The warm handshakes, the smiles, thank you for all of that. But dear God, we've now read your word, and we want to hear from you today. We want to hear what you've got for us. I'm praying right now for that man. He's here, but he's cold inside. He's far from you. Revive that man today. And then, dear God, I pray for that woman. That woman that's let everything in the world become more important than you. Her home, her children, her career, her hobbies. And I pray, dear God, that you could be first in her life. Revive that woman. I pray for someone in this room that doesn't know for sure that Jesus Christ is their King and their leader and their Savior and their Lord. And today they'd see their need for Jesus and come and be saved. Heavenly Father, we give you the next few moments. You take them. You bless them. Whatever you do, we'll give you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. I try in my meetings to be very punctual, and I'm going to tell you that this week we will get you in and get you out. The services will not be long. I was born and raised in Oklahoma, and that's oil country, and we believe if you don't strike oil, quit boring, all right? So we will not be long, but I will tell you right now, it's about 9 minutes till 12. And I don't have any nine-minute messages. So I'm going to preach as fast as I can. But remember, we got cake and ice cream afterwards, all right? So you bear with me this morning. And during the week, we'll be more punctual to get you in and get you out quickly. quickly. I believe in that very strongly. Well, we're reading from the book of 1 Peter. And the book of 1 Peter has been called the Epistle of the Living Hope. You know why? Because Peter was laying down hope to a Christian people that lived in a very antagonistic and hostile world. Do you realize that in the day that Peter lived, Christians were fed to lions? They were put in with the gladiators and hacked up just for entertainment. I've been to Rome and I've been to the Colosseum, and it's amazing today how the Italian government rewrites history and tells us that nobody ever died in the Colosseums and there was no Christians ever offered up. And those are all lies to try to rewrite history and make it look better. No, they lived in a horrible society. Even Rome took Christians, tied them to poles, rolled them in oil, and then put them up over Roman parties. And when the sun would set, they would take a torch and light their bodies. And literally their bodies would burn as human torches. You see, Peter lived in a world where it was hard to be a Christian. And you know, today I praise God that we live in the United States where we have freedoms and we've got the Bible and we can worship. But I do not believe it's getting easier to be a Christian. Harder every day. You know why? Because the philosophy of the world is closing down around us. And many people accuse us of hate speech and being homophobic and all the other accusations they can make. You know why? Not because they hate us, but they hate God and His Word. And you see, Peter stood up to these people and said, "Listen to me. We can still have victory. We can still overcome." And I'm going to tell you this morning, I do believe that we can still have revival. If I didn't believe that, I'd go home and get my Lazy Boy recliner and put my feet up and forget about all this traveling. But you know what? Every week I come to a church, I believe we can have revival. But if we're going to have revival, we're going to have to follow the same key that Peter lays down. And that's what I've entitled this message, Peter's Three Keys to Revival. These are a must if we're going to have revival. The first one I saw right there in verse number 5, where he says, "Likewise, ye younger, submit yourself unto the elder, ye all of you be subject one to another, and be clothed with humility." There's our first key to revival. Before Revived Baptist Church or any church can have a revival, it's going to take a humbling of yourself. Humility is always step one. What is the great revival verse in the Bible? 2 Chronicles 7:14. What does it say? "If my people, which are called by my name, shall sing," is that what it says? Tithe, huh? Go to church? No, it says humble themselves and then pray. Do you realize that humility is the great first step of revival? And in this verse we read, the humility is broken down into two stages. Notice it starts out by saying, "Ye younger." You know what that word there means? That means the followers. That's talking to you, the people in this church. Isn't that something? You're referred to as the younger. You're the followers. Then the Bible says that the first step of Christian humility is to submit yourself unto the elder. Now, it doesn't say the elderly. No, it's the word elder. And the word elder comes from the Greek word, which is the word presbyteros, is where we get the word presbyter. It's where we get the word pastor. Do you understand that the word elder and pastor in the Bible is the same person? And the elder of Revived Baptist Church is Anthony Smith. You say, "Wow. I'm older than he is. Well, honey, enjoy today. Because the Bible says you're the younger today. Mm-hmm. You're the followers. He's the elder. And I want you to notice the first step of humility in verse 5. It says that you are to submit yourself unto the elder. Wow. Now, this is not popular preaching today. I understand churches are run by deacon boards or trustee committees, and I was even in one church had a board of directors. Do you realize the church doesn't need a deacon board to run it? The church doesn't need a trustee committee to run it because the church has already got a leader. And you know who the leader of the church is? Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the head of Revived Baptist Church. He is the good shepherd. You are the sheep. Not a dumber animal out there. Don't get mad at me. I didn't write it. I'm just telling you what the Bible says. You're the sheep. He's the shepherd. Brother Anthony, you're not the shepherd. Jesus is the shepherd. But folks, Brother Anthony is not just one of you sheep. You say, well, what is he? Is he the under-shepherd? Is he the assistant shepherd? Well, personally, I like to call him the sheepdog. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was up in Colorado one day, and I was watching that shepherd with his sheepdog and his flock. And I'm going to tell you, that dog's got one job. You know what that dog's job is? Keep the sheep following the shepherd. That's his job. And I'm going to tell you right now, Brother Anthony, that is your one job. Keep these people following Jesus Christ. And I'm going to say to you, you need to submit yourself unto your pastor. Now, I've been all over America. I've been around the world 18 times. I've been in 650 revival meetings. I've met a lot of preachers. And I'm going to tell you something about Anthony Smith this morning, and you listen to me. I'll tell you about that young man that's your elder, your pastor. You know what it is? He's not the sharpest knife in the drawer. No. I'm sorry, Lacey. It always hurts his wife more because you married him. Uh-huh. Some of you are like, what are you saying about my preacher? Well, let me tell you what I'm saying about your preacher. There could be somebody in this church that's a better preacher than him. There could be somebody in this church that's a better money manager than him. There could be somebody that's a better administrator or people person than Anthony Smith. But do you realize that Anthony Smith is the only one that God has called to be the pastor of this church? And until he calls you to be the pastor of this church, the Bible says right here, you're supposed to submit to your pastor. You're supposed to humble yourself. And let me just tell you right now, don't get mad at your preacher when he does his job. I watched that sheepdog one day, and there were, you know, the sheep were following that shepherd pretty good, but there was always one knot-headed one out here. Do-do-do-do-do-do. Going the wrong way. Boy, and that dog ran over there and got nose to nose with that sheep. And then, boy, that sheep took off and ran right up behind the shepherd. There was another one more knot-headed than the first, and he bit that sheep right in the haunch. And boy, that sheep took off for the shepherd. You see, some Sunday you're going to come to church here, and Brother Anthony's going to be up here preaching just the sweetest message that's blessing your heart, and all of a sudden he's going to go, he's going to get on your sin. He's going to walk on your toes. Don't get mad at him. He's doing his job. And have you ever walked out of church when the preacher took a notch out of you? You ought to thank God you got a preacher that'll take a notch out of you. He's doing his job. Church, the first step of Christian humility is humbling yourself to submit to your own pastor. And if you can't do that, you're never going to have a revival. Notice the second step in verse number 5. It says, yea, all of you be subject one to another. You know what the second step of Christian humility is? Learning how to get along with each other. I see in churches today, people are mad at each other. Well, they didn't shake my hand. They sat in my chair. They parked in my parking spot. They said, I always take the offering right here, and he took my spot. Well, you know what? True Christian humility is learning to get along with each other. Because people are getting mad every Sunday in churches all over America. I'm mad. I'm going to another church over the stupidest stuff, over the most minute affairs. Let me tell you something. If you're faithful to this church, do you realize there's 52 Sunday mornings? And there's 52 Sunday nights and 52 Wednesday nights. And if you're faithful, you're hanging around with the same people a lot. And you mark it down, there's going to be a day they're going to tick you off. There's going to be a day that someone shows up in a bad mood. Some of you can tell by the look on your face, today's the day. I'm sorry. But sometimes you need to just humble yourself and say, they didn't shake my hand. Maybe they just need a hug. Maybe they just need to be left alone. Maybe I just ought to humble myself and not worry about getting offended by that person. You know what? True Christian humility, submit to your pastor and then be subject one to another. Revived Baptist, you want to have revival? The great peacekeeper in the church is humility. We got to humble ourselves and watch God bless us. What did it say? For God resisteth the proud, verse 5, and he giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. You see, if you go down and humble yourself, the Bible says that God's got a mighty hand, and he will scoop you up and exalt you. But I'm going to tell you, when you puff up with pride and get full of yourself, the mighty hand of God will turn over and grab you by your coattail and bring you down every time. That WWF wrestling, you ever watch that? Only four of you do. Boy, that one guy will beat that other guy, and you think, oh, it's all over. And then that guy will get up off the mat, and he'll start fighting, and then he'll get cocky, and he'll start knocking that guy, and all of a sudden that guy will take him and lift him up and throw him on. And oh, I've watched Christians do that so many times. Your life was a mess. You found Jesus Christ. You got into church. Marriage got better. Your family got better. Your income got better. Then all of a sudden you get cocky. I'm doing good. And I've watched them go right down on their back again, humbled, because they took their eyes off of Jesus Christ. Humble yourself if you want revival. Secondly, look at verse number seven. It says, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. You know what the second key to revival is? Learning to completely trust God with the cares and trials of your life. Casting all your cares upon him. Now, I don't know if you know it or not, but do you know that in the day that Peter lived, they didn't have UPS? Did you know that? They didn't have FedEx truck lines. And I told Anthony I wouldn't try to do much of this, but I'm getting out of camera here, but maybe they can hold on to me a minute. Let me get a chair here. This will be my example. Do you realize that in the day that Peter lived, the trucking lines of that day were men, and they would put humongous burdens. That's a heavy chair. Duh! They would put humongous burdens on their back. You see, the streets were so narrow, you couldn't get a cart or a little chariot down the street, so they would carry these burdens on their back. In the day that Peter lived, these were literally called beast of burden. They were the men trucking lines of that day. You talk about a job where you're bent over double all day long.
running through the city streets. But if you'd see your friend, Gary, what's your boy's name there? Levi, come up and help me. Would you, Levi? Come on up. If I'd see a friend like Levi, you know what he'd do? He'd help get that burden off my back. Now, hold on, Levi. If it was that easy, why don't I just put it on the ground and take a break? The problem is, Levi, these burdens were so humongous, if we ever got it down on the ground, we'd never get it back on my back again. So, Levi, the only way you could help me is you got to get over here shoulder to shoulder with me and bend over like I'm bent over, and I've got to cast this burden over on your back. Now, hold on, Levi, hold on. I'm going to cast it over on your back. All right, get down. I would worry about messing up your hair, but I don't think I have to worry about that. All right, here we go. I don't have any, so I don't have to worry about it. All right, Levi, here we go. It's coming over. It's coming over, Levi. Get it on your back. Get it on your back. Bend over and get it on your back. Get down, Levi. It's heavy. It's heavy. Whew, thank you. Do you know what your friend would do? They wouldn't carry your burden. They would just let you cast your burden over on them. And sometimes, Levi, they'd hold it for like 20 minutes while I rest my back, all right? You just stand there and hold it. Get down. It's heavy. They wouldn't carry it one step because it was my job. But they would let you cast your burden on their back. I want you to realize verse 7 is an illustration that Peter is giving us that these people saw every day of their life. They saw men casting a heavy burden over on the back of someone else. And then I'd say, okay, Levi, I'm glad you come by. I got to go. I got to deliver this cargo. And you'd bring it back over. Hey, man, meet me here same time tomorrow. Talk to you later. Bye-bye. All right, thank you. Give Levi a hand there. Now, I want you to realize that's exactly what the Lord is saying to you. You got a heavy burden? You got something on your back? The Lord said, cast your cares on me. You see, some of you walked into church this morning, and when someone shook your hand, how are you doing? Do you realize that's a rhetorical question? We really don't want to know the answer. But most of us will answer, oh, just fine, oh, just great. And the truth be, you came to church this morning and you're not just fine. You're not really great. There's a few of you this morning, you don't know if you'll be married this time next month. Your marriage is such a mess. Some of you have got health issues. You've been to the doctor and they saw a spot. And the doctor even used the word cancer. Some of you, you've got kid problems. And if you've got teenagers, you've got kid problems. Amen. Some of you heard they're going to be laying people off because of the inflation and the upcoming recession. You came into this building with a big old burden on your back. And I'm going to tell you this morning that God said, slip up beside me and cast that care on me. You know, I can preach a message like this and people will come down to the altar and lay a big old burden down on the altar. They leave. I'm going to tell you it's better than the Atkins diet. It's better than the South Beach diet, because when you cast your burden on the Lord, you feel 30 pounds lighter. But you know what happens, Brother Anthony? About 3 o'clock in the morning, a car pulls up out here, and they pick that lock, and they come down this aisle, and they pick that burden right back up. And they've got it before the night is over, right on their back. My daddy, he was a master fisherman. And I'll never forget, he started me out with a cane pole. Did you ever cane pole fish? Cane pole, a line, a cork, a hook. Boop, boop, boop. Boring. When I was about 8 years old, he bought me my first Zebco 101. It was black and white. We went out to Melton's farm pond. Dad put a big old sloppy worm on it. I remember, I dreamed of this day. I got my leg out there just right. I got my tongue just right. I pulled that thing back. That worm come back and hit me right in the face. I remember I'm like, Dad, I did something wrong. And I remember old Dad, he said, Kent, oh, you were doing so good. You had your leg just right. You had your tongue just right. Your cast was good, but Kent, right at the end of your cast, you forgot to release it. Do you realize you cannot cast something until you release it? You must release it. You say, Brother Kent, but it's my health. Brother Kent, it's my family. Brother Kent, it's my marriage. Give it to the Lord. He says, cast all your cares on me. Why? Because I care about you. Wow. Have you thought about that? You are a microscopic speck on a mud ball flying through outer space, and God cares about you. You know what the second key to revival is? You got to trust God with all the cares of your life. And then thirdly, and I'm done, I'll quit. Verse number 8 says, be sober, be vigilant. Because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. You know what the third key to revival is, church? We've got to set a watch for the devil. The devil's not a joke. He's not just a guy on a Tabasco can. He's not just something you dress up at Halloween and laugh about. The devil is your adversary. Here the Bible says the devil is a roaring lion. And they tell me that lions don't walk around roaring all day long. Lions spend most of their life in silence. But they tell me if you shoot a lion or you wound him, you don't kill him, but he's wounded, he will become what they refer to as a roaring lion. Meaning a lion only kills to eat and protect himself, but if he's wounded and he's bleeding and he's dying and he's angry, he'll kill everything he comes in contact with. He is a roaring lion. And you need to realize that on the third day when Jesus Christ came up out of that tomb, bam, right then, Jesus put the death blow on Satan. And today he is that roaring lion, roar, seeking whom he may devour. I don't know if y'all ever do it here, Brother Anthony, but I pastored for 18 years and some Sunday mornings I'd get up and say, hey, tonight after the evening service, we're going to have an afterglow. If your last name starts with A to M, you bring sandwiches. N to Z, you bring desserts. And I mean Sunday night, here comes all the women carrying the food in. Oh, the smell in the fellowship hall is coming into the auditorium, and Sunday night everybody's looking at you like, shut up, so we can go eat. As soon as you say amen, the sweet ladies go back there and they set all that food out on long tables. The kids run back there. The men wait around in the auditorium a little bit, you know. Men walk different on afterglow night. They're kind of like going back to the afterglow. And then those men walk up to the end of that table. They get their styrofoam plate. Ooh, I need a dip of that, and I want two of those, and I need a slice of that right in there. You say, what are those men doing? Seeking what they may devour. Now, there's one lady in this church. Don't point. She's here. We love you. Everything you bring is so good. Oh. If she brings tuna fish salad, it's the best in the world. If she makes a coconut cream pie, oh, it stands up that high. Oh, it's so good. We love you. And when you're going through the line, people will go, you better get some of that. She made that. Oh, she made that. It's like a feeding frenzy on her food. We love you. Now there's another lady in the church. She's here too. Don't point. Everything she brings. I don't care what she brings to a church dinner. It tastes kind of funky. It ain't right. And you know us men, we've got our signs. As you're going through the line and you're dipping some of her food, the guy across the table's going, no. She made that. Oh. Don't point. There's a couple of you ladies right now, you're kind of like, is it me? Just cast it on the Lord. We're never going to tell you. Now, what are you talking about? You see, the Bible says Satan comes to Revive Baptist Church and gets his styrofoam plate. He's seeking whom he may devour. You say, what tastes good to the devil? A family that no longer puts Christ first in their home. A family that used to sit down to eat and they bowed their head and gave God thanks for the food. A family that when they watched a movie at home or they rented one at the Red Box, they were careful what they rented. Now they'll watch any old garbage. A family where you never heard curse words, but now it's part of the regular vocabulary of that house. A family that used to be in church every time the door was open, but now we're lucky to see them two or three times a year. You show me a family like that, and I'll show you a family that tastes awful good to the devil, and he's seeking whom he may devour. But I'm going to tell you, when you put Christ first and keep him the center of your home, you are a bite that the devil can't handle. He can't swallow it. You see, the devil is looking to destroy you and your family. When I was a kid, my dad was a big revival preacher. He pastored the Bible Baptist Church in Chickasha, Oklahoma. Back then, Brother Anthony, the revivals weren't Sunday through Wednesday. They were Sunday through Sunday. The full week. 8 days. Mom and Dad would fly off somewhere, and me and my brothers, there we were. Now, you'll leave your kids with a 14-year-old girl that'll babysit them for a few hours. But when you're gone 8 days, you leave your kids with people you trust. And there was a couple in our church, Bill and Lavina White was their name. They had kids our age. When Mom and Dad went out of town, we stayed with Bill and Lavina. She was my Sunday school teacher. She used to button my shirt up for me and cut the meat up on my plate when I stayed at her house. Bill was a trustee at the church. They were some of the best people we ever knew. Started on a Wednesday night. Bill and Lavina didn't show up for prayer meeting that night. Someone said, where's Bill and Lavina? Someone said, well, we went by their house and they were painting their house. Oh, okay, well, we understood, but it was odd they'd be painting their house on a Wednesday night because they're always in church. And then after that, it wasn't long, they couldn't come back Sunday night. You know, that big service on, that Sunday morning service just wore us out. We couldn't come back Sunday night. Wasn't long after that, Bill and Lavina came to my dad's office and said, we want to give up our duties. Bill said, I'm real busy at work and I can't be a trustee anymore. And Lavina said, those boys are really driving me crazy and I need a sabbatical from the Sunday school class. They gave up their duties. Oh, they were still coming for the morning worship at 11 o'clock. And then they started missing that once a month, and then they came every 3 months, and then they came Christmas and Easter, and then Bill and Lavina and the three kids were gone. Dad would go visit them, and they'd say, we're going to be there Sunday, but they would never show up. Word came back to the church that Bill and Lavina had separated, and they were going to get a divorce. Broke everybody's heart. The news was even worse. Bill had started going to bars, staying late at bars in Chickasha. Lavina was having a hard time making ends meet, so she took a job as a cocktail waitress at a nightclub on the edge of town. That was my Sunday school teacher. I'll never forget that Wednesday night. We were having prayer meeting, and Bill walked in and sat on the back pew, right on the aisle. During prayer request, he said, please pray for the White family. Everybody was glad to see Bill. Everybody loved Bill and Lavina. After the service, he went out and got in his car, and three men from the church. I was 14 years old that night. I eavesdropped from the nose of the car. Those three men stood there and told Bill, get back to serving God. Get back in church. God can put your marriage back together. God can get your kids back. I'll never forget, Bill put his head down and rubbed his forehead and said, oh, I wish I could. I can still see the taillights of his car going down 13th Street as he pulled away. We didn't know that he went directly from church to a bar and started drinking. The bar closed around 1 a.m., and he knew Lavina got off at the same hour out at the nightclub. She picked up her kids at the babysitter and had just got to their house when Bill come to the front door and started beating on the door. Open the door! Let me in! You're my family! Lavina said, Bill, it's late, and the kids are tired, and you've been drinking. Come back tomorrow. You open this door right now! He started taking his shoulder, hitting the door. They lived in an older home that had two front doors with kind of a breezeway. Her oldest son, which was my age, 14, he ran out in that breezeway with his mama, and they were holding that door, and Bill was hitting it with his shoulder. Bill was yelling, and his Lavina was screaming, and the kids were crying. It's a horrible scene at 2 o'clock in the morning. And finally, he busted that jam and put his foot in that door, and they pushed back, but they couldn't close that door. Bill had a jacket on that night. He reached down in his jacket pocket, and he had a .22 revolver in his pocket, and he stuck it up through the crack of that door, and he fired one shot. It was dark. He didn't know where he was shooting. He struck Lavina right in the middle of her stomach. It wasn't a fatal wound, but there was blood, and when it hit her, she let go of that door, and that boy did too, and they ran back in the living room. Lavina fell down on her knees in the middle of the living room floor, hands covered with blood. All three kids made a circle in front of their mama. And when Bill walked into that living room, that oldest boy said, Daddy, you go away. You leave mama alone. You've already hurt mama. Now you go away. And Bill walked around his three kids. Lavina had long black hair all the way to the middle of her back. She is a beautiful woman. And he cupped her hair and pulled it right down to the end. And then he curled her hair around his fist. And he pulled her hair straight up. He put that .22 right on her temple. And in front of all three of his kids, he shot her right through the head. And if you've ever seen a .22 exit wound, it was just a small hole with blood running down her cheek. And her youngest son, who was about 4 years old, when he saw his mama bleeding, you know what he did? He ran up there and put his finger over that hole. And Bill fired that gun again and shot the tip of that little boy's finger right off. And then Bill took the gun and put it to his head and fired one shot. Bill died at 7:30 at the hospital, and Lavina died at 8:30 at the hospital. And I gotta believe Satan said, he devoured the White family. Now, some of you are looking at me right now like, Brother Kent, that don't sound like a very good Christian family. Let me tell you, they were some of the best people I ever knew in my life. They were some of the sweetest Christian people I ever knew. But you know what happened? Satan got his foot in the door. And he didn't stop till he devoured it. And there's some of you in this room right now, you're playing church. You show up on Sunday as a social event. Daddy, Satan wants to devour your home. He wants you divorced and living in a cheap apartment by yourself. Mama, Satan wants your babies. He wants them strung out on drugs and alcohol. He wants your home destroyed. And it's time that some of you do exactly what Peter said. Be sober! Set a watch! Get serious about serving God. Because he is a roaring lion. And he's after you. You know, this morning, I think Peter's right on track. These are the three keys to revival. Now, I've shared the keys with you. Whether you take them and put them in the lock, that's up to you. But Revive Baptist, you're not going to be revived until we do these three things. Would you stand with me this morning? I'm going to ask that every head be bowed and every eye closed. I'm going to ask our pianist to come, and as soon as she gets to the piano, to play very softly. I'm going to ask Gary to come and get a mic, and he's going to sing our invitation number for us this morning. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Nobody moving, just being very still. Just a time of solemn examination of your own heart. Who here today would say, Brother Kent, I am a Christian. I remember a time and a place when I got saved. I know I'm saved. I know I'm going to heaven. But today the message spoke to me, Brother Kent. Somewhere it came down my row and it spoke to my heart. And you'd say, Brother Kent, I wish you'd pray for me this morning. How many Christians are like that could hold your hand up high for just a moment? Hold them high so I can see them. Yes. Hands in every section. Yes. More. More. Yes. Thank you. You can put them down. Thank you. You know what that tells me? Good news. The Spirit of God's working on hearts today. That's the beginning of revival. Maybe there's someone here to say, Brother Ken, I've never been saved. I've never trusted Jesus. And I care about my soul. I don't know if I died tonight, I'd go to heaven. But Brother Kent, I wish you'd pray for me. Now, I'm not going to ask you to put your hand up. I don't want anybody to see you. Every head's bowed, every chin's tucked low. If you'd like me to pray for you this morning for your soul, I'm just going to ask you to lift your head up and just look at me. And when our eyes meet, you can put your head right back down. Yes, I see you. Thank you. Who else? Yes, I see you. Thank you. I'm looking across this building. Just lift that head and just look at me. It'll take every bit of courage you got. I won't embarrass you. I just want to pray for you. Who else is like that? Just lift that head. Brother Ken, I'm not saved, but I wish you'd pray for me. I'm going to have a word of prayer. And then Brother Gary's going to sing for us. I'm going to ask Brother Anthony to get his Bible and come right down here to the front and stand right here in front of this pulpit. He's going to be right here to meet you. If you're a Christian and you lifted your hand, I'm going to challenge you just to come to the altar. Don't bother the pastor. Just get down on your knees. Whatever got your hand in the air, give it to the Lord. If you were one of those that said, I'm not sure I'm saved, or I know I'm not saved, I want you to walk straight to Brother Anthony and just say, I want to get saved. He'll know exactly what you mean. He'll have someone go pray with you and show you how to trust Jesus today. Heavenly Father, thank you for Peter and for his good word today. Lord, I'm praying first for Christians in this room. You've dealt with their heart in some way. I'm praying revival will start down on their knees at this altar. And wherever you spoke to them, they'd say yes to you and your leading. And then, Lord, for these that looked at me, oh, how I respect their courage. How I respect they were willing to look at me and say, I need Jesus. I'm praying this morning they'd walk down to Brother Anthony and someone could show them how to get saved today. Dear Lord, this is your invitation. You take it. You bless it. We'll pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now look up here and listen to me just a minute. If God dealt with you today, let's don't mess around. In fact, Christians, you lead the way to this altar. Some are already down here. You come and lead the way to the altar. You need to be saved? Brother Anthony, come stand right here. He'll meet you right here at the altar. He'll have someone show you how to be saved. Amen. Folks are already coming. Come on. Come on today. Make that step for Jesus. Are you ready, Brother Gary? Sing it good and loud and pick it up a little bit. Come on. Here we go. Here we go. Come on. This is for you. Just as I am. That's exactly how he wants you to come. Sing it out. How about it, lost soul? Pastor's right here. Just take that step. Meet him here. How about it, Christian? God deal with you today? Only way to have revival is to say yes to God when he deals with you. Sing it again, Brother
Just
Gary.
As you are. I am without one.
Why don't you come today?
But
why don't you come, lost soul, and be saved
blood
today? Satan's a roaring lion. He wants to devour your soul. Don't let him do it.
Thou bidst
come and trust
me
him.
Come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come.
Just a minute, Brother Gary. I'm going to have him sing one last verse, and I'll give it to the preacher. You know, sometimes we think of, oh, I can just get out of here, I'll feel better. You're not. You're going to feel worse. You feel better when you get right. You feel better when you get saved. I'm going to sing one more verse. If you need to come, this is your verse. Daddy, how long has it been since you took Mama by the hand and said, let's go down there and pray for our family? Be a leader today. Don't let Satan devour you. Brother Gary, one more verse. Sing it good now. Come on.
Just as I am without
Pastor's right here, ready to
receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, because thy promise I believe, O Lamb of God, I come.
Thank you for being a wonderful audience this morning, and I want to remind you that after every service, I'll be back. I have a table in the back. I've got a good old-fashioned Oklahoma yard sale going on back there, and no, that table has got Christian t-shirts and caps, and they're wonderful witness wear, and when you buy one, you'll be helping Ignite Ministry go around the world, and we would appreciate it. You can write a check. I've got some change, and you can use any credit card in the world or debit card back there, and you might find a shirt that could help you witness in your daily life. Well, we got one. Go ahead and be seated, if you will, for just a minute. We have Brother Anthony. I was going to turn it over to you, but we got one more thing of business. Brother Tim is coming, and I received staunch orders to turn it over to Tim. And not you. So, Brother Tim, it's all yours.
All right, well. All right, so this is the eighth anniversary of church, but it's also the pastor's eighth anniversary. I don't see Liam out there, so if somebody can run up and get Liam and have him come down. I think he's upstairs in the class. Okay. And Lydia, you can come on up as well. All right, come on down, Lydia. Lacey, come on up. So, you know, we appreciate everything you all do. You know, with the pastors, the sheepdog, as was said today, you know. But, you know, he can't do this without the support of his wife. And, you know, the kids didn't ask to be the pastor's kids, right? And so we just want to ask that the Lord protect the whole family, protect the service and the ministry, their ministry and the church. So I've asked Brother York if he would lead in a prayer. I'd also like to ask Rob to come up. He's one of the other trustees in the church. And if Brother York would go ahead and lead in prayer over the family and come on forward. And then we've got this we'd like to present to them as a thanks from the church. I was going to do that because I knew you would do that anyway. So if you could circle around.
I was already taking my mic off, so I'll use yours. Y'all come around, you men. Put some hands on them there. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you this morning, and we're so thankful for the Smith family, for the faith that it took for them to come to London and start Revive Baptist Church. Lord, thank you, because I know they've had hard times, discouraging times, and then wonderful blessings also. And I pray that your blessings would be on this family, and that you'd let them continue to lead this church to new heights. Thank you for the generosity of the church to give them a gift, just to say, we love you. And we look forward to what you've got in store, not only for the church, but for this family in the future. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. All right, I'll let the pastor have his church back now.
Well, have you enjoyed Brother Kent this morning? Amen. Been a blessing. Actually, Tim, if I could get you and George. We need one thing we always do when we have a special guest speaker come in. The church, we always do take care of their expenses. But we did want to take a love offering for Brother Kent York and his time. We are grateful that he does not live in Chickasha, Oklahoma anymore. And we're excited to have him in Ohio. And if you guys would come, Lacey, if you could make sure the cake and everything's ready. I think everything's ready to go. You guys just go ahead. If you know sometimes you may not have cash or a check. If you'd like to give, just go to our website, go to Tithely, and just put in a special message that you want it to go to Brother Kent York, and Tim will make sure that Brother Kent receives that. So today is our 8-year anniversary. We're excited, and we do have cake and ice cream. If you've not had Valerie Farmhouse Bakery cake, it is absolutely phenomenal. And it also came with cupcakes. There was one cupcake missing, and listen, it fell out, okay? It fell out. I didn't eat it. It fell out. I promise that. And I'm not going to lie in church. Tonight, food will start at 5 o'clock. Miss Nita, what are we having tonight?
Sloppy Joe.
Oh. Great. Yes. So we're going to have a great time fellowship. I always talk about, we need to be a church family, not church acquaintances. Be here 5 o'clock. I know you could get food at your house or whatever on a Sunday night, but be here 5 o'clock. Let's eat together, enjoy one another's company, and then we're going to continue the revival at 6 p.m., and then Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, food starts at 6 o'clock, and then services will start at 7. This is a great time to invite somebody to come to our church. They don't have scheduled services, especially Monday, Tuesday. And you know what? You might know somebody just needs some reviving in their life. And if they don't stay with us, that's okay. But they can come worship with us, hear Brother Kent, get a blessing, and just get revived. Amen? And that's what we're praying for. So let's pray. You'll go downstairs through the kitchen. You'll see the cake and ice cream down there. And then we did get just finished up yesterday. If you go downstairs to the room, all the way to the left is all been cleared out, and it has tables and chairs in there for everybody to sit down and eat. Cake and ice cream. Give your kids a good sugar high before you take them home, all right? Yes, sir.
But my team leaders strategically locate themselves.
Yes.
When you say amen,
yes. All right, yeah. So team leaders, if you guys want to make your way to your positions, maybe close to the cake, I don't know. But get ready.
And we're going to have a great rumble this week. We did do, for the winners, I think, brother, did you go over the prizes with them?
Yeah.
Okay, so you know what the prize, I think it's pretty good, so. Okay, Wednesday. Okay, well, that's all right, because I was getting ready to spill the beans, so, as I've done that, so I will not do that. Well, let's pray, and we'll go eat some cake and ice cream and fellowship. Heavenly Father, we come before you today so grateful. Lord, we thank you so much for Brother Kent York and his message that spoke to our hearts today. Lord, of just giving you our cares, our burdens, casting them to you. Lord, we pray that you bless our time of revival. We know many churches don't see the importance of revival, but Lord, as we've already seen in the very first service of what it's already doing in our lives, seeing our hearts being moved and our minds being put on you, God, I ask that you bless the time of fellowship and bless us this week that we will see great reviving every night. We praise you and love you. In Jesus' name, amen.